More than 200 years ago, Americans fought a revolution. A revolution against big government.
He has erected a multitude of new offices and has sent hither swarms of officials to harass our people and eat out their substance.
George III and his bureaucrats taxed and controlled their lives until the people said, enough. Today, the government in Washington, D.C. makes you nostalgic for old King George. The royal tax collectors took about 25% from our ancestors. This year, government at all levels will extract 5% of our money to waste. And not gently. IRS agents use wiretaps, mail openings, informants, disguises, guns, chains, and jails to get every last dime. Meanwhile, at the Federal Reserve, 12 faceless bureaucrats decide your economic future. In secret. How much inflation should there be next year? What should interest rates be? How much of your savings should be transferred to politicians and their favored big banks? The Supreme Court, where individual rights are supposed to be protected, think it's fine if government invades our financial privacy, spies on us in our bedrooms, regulates church schools, and restricts our free speech. Meanwhile, at the Congress, everything is up for grabs, as long as it's yours.
I'm Pamela Wistrom, co-host of On Second Thought. And now, for the host and star of this 14-year, weekly-long TV show. Oh, are you ready? The one and only William J. Wagner!
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Pamela. Tonight, people, we have a show. We have the California 18, or most of them, here on the set. Unfortunately, a few of them were not able to be here tonight, but we have a large crowd here. Among the California 18 here, we hope you will get to know how to defend yourself against what I call the merciless bank gangsters. I'm not an expert, but we've got some people who are close as anything you're ever going to meet to an expert, each in their own specific field. So please pay close attention. With me as our first guest here on the studio is Jack. Jack Sooty, thanks for being with us, Jack. Tell us what you want to, tell us what we need to know.
Okay. Thank you, Ellen, for having all of the most of us, the California 18. What a pleasure to have us here as a group. I'm looking at you all for the first time together, and I'll tell you, it's an impressive thing. We are fed up with our judiciary and our prosecutors. We are here gathered because our hearts are pouring out to you, the listeners, to believe that there is corruptness out there going on with our titles, with our properties. They're being stolen, and we need to have your help with us getting the ear of the Attorney General to produce some prosecutions. We know for a fact that people are out there still to this day, after the settlements, after the agreements with the banks, that are still committing fraud. These are not misdemeanors, these are not petty offenses or infractions. These are felonious accounts that people are still doing, and nobody is getting prosecuted. We need to stop this. Our prosecuting agencies have a responsibility, and they've taken an oath to enforce it, and we're sick and tired of the fact they're not doing anything. I myself am a victim. I need to have some justice. I can't get it. For 4 years, I've been fighting my bank, and nothing's been done to prosecute the four felonies. Nothing. I've asked three agencies, San Diego County DA, Ventura County DA, and now the Attorney General. They don't return my calls, write me back, they ignore me. That's not justice.
Wow. Yay. Jack, tell me, is there a website you would recommend people to look at?
Well, I think you have to be careful when you're on the internet and anywhere you go. We're probably going to be feeding you some information here down the road that will tend to give you some direction as to where you can go. Each of us has our own way here tonight, and some of us will be giving you some websites or ideas of where to go. I know an old site that we used to be on and we started a long time ago was called Homeowners for Justice. CJ Holmes started that. She was the founder of the California 18 and why we are here. We have 18 spreadsheets that we put together, and it's a large document that we had blown up. I have an assignment of my deed of trust, which is one of the three or four documents that everybody has on their land record, usually, predominantly, and it's the first step that the bank uses to falsify records. They record this on your property. They don't have the legal right most of the time to even do it. It's not their loan. They hide behind the crowd of judges who support them because they won't send them to jail.
Is that the document there?
This is an assignment of deed of trust, and what this is the first document of many, including some promissory notes that are being forged, and the signature that you see scribbled there, that is supposed to be the legal signature on a legal document, and it's not. You'll see it's a scribbling. And the gentleman's name that's there, Mortgage Electronic Registration Systems, has no knowledge of who he is. And yet he signed it as a representative of theirs.
Wow, is that a robo-signature?
It most certainly is. And it's still going on to this day.
Jack, tell us your credentials.
I'm a former police officer from Illinois in San Diego. Been a licensed detective, licensed in California. And part of the time I was licensed in Nevada as a private investigator. I'm a forensic specialist dealing with mortgage fraud and the representation of title fraud, and I work with many other people, including my peers here tonight. I've got about 6,000 investigations under my belt, and I've saved 20 people.
That's certainly worth a giant applause. That's certainly worth a giant applause. Thank you, Jack. I really appreciate you being here. Now we're going to turn to my next guest, Renee. Renee's on my side. Thank you, Renee, for being here.
Thank you, William. Thank you very much.
Tell us what you think people should know, Renee.
Well, what I think you should know is that if you're paying a mortgage or you think you're paying a mortgage, you might want to look into who you're actually paying. We can tell you unequivocally that we have none of us seen a legal document for anyone with a right to take your home or to collect money from you. We approached a year ago C.J. Holmes, our founder. We've got to give her a round. C.J.'s the reason. C.J. Holmes amazingly brought together a show. We did a daily show for an hour in education. Through this show, we found that oaths and bonds were being violated. We found that we all came together with all our illegal documents with Recon Trust and Bank of America. And so what happened was, those were the two starting. Now, I can tell you, everyone here, we represent every fraudster in the nation and the world. This doesn't just mean the United States, it goes international. We have every bank involved, not just, we have Bank of America, Wells Fargo, Deutsche Bank, we have Chase, JP Morgan. Thank you, Mr. Diamond, because you're still in Holmes and you're still in your chair. We're out to get you. You're gonna leave that chair unless you can get into a chair we really would like to see you in. We've got every servicer, Ocwen, Litton, Aurora. We have Recon Trust, we have Quality Loan Servicing, two of which in California are not paying any property or business taxes. We cannot find them paying business taxes any county in California.
Who is this, Renee?
Recon Trust, who is part of why we, the 18, are together.
And they're registered in California.
And they're not paying any business taxes.
And they pay no taxes.
Zero. Oh, but Quality Loan Servicing does in Washington.
Norm Veroman was the good DA of Mendocino County, who riled the federals, got them really upset, and we're not going to go into that issue. But my point is, from every county, if you form your own militia, I mean armed men and women who are not only armed, but trained and ready to march to enforce the second thing that needs to be done. You need we the people, like that's behind me on this banner, we the people, grand juries, not appointed by any crooked judge in the county. And I have this on the authority of Justice Scalia, of the U.S. Supreme Court says the grand juries do not belong to the judiciary, they don't belong to the executive, and they don't belong to the legislative. This is we the people's time when we see things are so bad, gone so far south, we the people spontaneously form our own grand juries. We impanel, we take an oath, we choose a foreman, we choose a secretary and a recording officer. Then we call in the witnesses, and the witnesses come and testify under oath. It's all kept just like you do on these bogus grand juries that they use now. And then they issue what's called a true bill of indictment for the judge, for the congressman who took kickbacks and mutter into the table. I mean, Cunningham's in prison down from San Diego, and he was supposedly the golden boy who was going to save everything. He's doing time right now. I can tell you for a certain fact, more than half of all of the 435 congressmen have taken kickbacks. And you never see a congressman go into Congress worth only $200,000 net worth and come out only $200,000 net worth. Every one of those guys comes out worth multi-millions. Where do they get the multi-millions from? Yeah, where do they get those multi-millions? How do you go in with a congressional salary with all your expenses and come out with multiple millions of dollars? I think it's called insider trading, passing laws that will increase the value of the stocks you've been pre-programmed to buy before they change the law. So Congress is crooked, most of it. I want to introduce you to our live guest here. That was a flashback, people, to our California 18 show, by the way. And if you want to see the rest of it, you'll find it on YouTube under the William Wagner channel, parts 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, I believe. And you'll see Candace Jones, a supervisor for B of A retired, telling you all these remortgage loans are fraud, all of them, not just a few of them, all of them. And she makes this grand statement. I've never heard a bank officer, retired or active, state. She says, you can't modify fraud. That's saying a lot. With me in the studio here live tonight on November 6th, Friday the 6th, is Sherry Hernandez. Welcome, Sherry.
Thank you for having me.
I'm delighted. You know those people, don't you? You know Jack Sooty and Renee. Or at least you know Renee.
I do know Renee, yes. And I also know about insider trading.
Do tell us.
I kept this document in my home.
Uh-huh. We are not deadbeats.
Yes.
Exhibit A. And it's signed by Assistant Vice President.
This is part of my settlement. This is part of my settlement from Countrywide on the settlement I'm not supposed to disclose, but I did insist on an apology letter. And at the bottom of the apology letter, it says here, if that is what happened, because they're not admitting what happened, Countrywide certainly does not condone that behavior and regrets that you were faced with that circumstance. Such conduct is inappropriate and should not have occurred. Countrywide is glad that all parties have now reached a final resolution.
And they're out of business now.
Well, they were out of business when this was written. It was through B of A. So Countrywide loans are still held by B of A. But there's a new illegitimate child on the block from Countrywide called PennyMac.
Oh, PennyMac.
And PennyMac is made of all the same executives, except Mozilla, that ran Countrywide. And Stanford Curlin, who is the CEO of PennyMac, was the CFO of Countrywide, right alongside Mozilla. So why did he get a new corporation while Mozilla got drummed out and called the worst CEO in history?
I don't know. Tell me.
It's a good question, but it's a question probably for Tim Geithner, whose idea it was. So at the same time that they were having the SEC grill Mozilla and Stanford Curlin, they were opening up PennyMac here in California.
Really?
Yes, really.
So they're drumming them down, bad boy, bad boy. They're bringing up a new model of the same
thing. Right, PennyMac. And you might want to ask, how PennyMac was able to get past the Department of Corporations here in California when Stanford Curlin, first of all, Angelo Mozilla was completely out. He had too many charges against him. But at the time PennyMac was open, Stanford Curlin had 50 cases filed against him in the civil court. But Preston Dufresne-Chard, who was the commissioner of the Department of Corporations, you will now find him as a trustee for PennyMac with 13,000 shares.
Wait a minute, that can't be.
Oh, yes. Public knowledge.
He can't wear two hats at the same time.
No, he didn't do it at the same time. First, he allowed them to open up their corporation, and after their corporation was open for a while, and he retired, and he went on to work as a trustee for them.
That's crooked as a $3 bill. I mean, you allow an illegality to happen with the same crooks setting it up, and then you go join them. You take off your government hat and put on your PennyMac hat.
Revolving door.
Well, let's add him to the list of bank gangsters that need to be arrested by the militia. You know, the militia actually occasionally, when things get stressed enough, they show up like they did at the Bundy Ranch in Nevada.
I did hear about that. And it didn't surprise me because I do hear around the country that militias are forming in various pockets of our country. And I can understand why with what they're doing with the banks.
We have a militia already formed in Santa Barbara County. They have, at last count, 32 armed members. They're mostly ranchers, farmers, and rural people, but there's a few city people, and they're very, very secretive. They will not come on my show. They do not want to be identified. But I just wonder, how bad does it have to get before they will step up to the plate, surround somebody's house, and arrest the bankers or their agents who are trying to take somebody's house away? And a couple of years ago, my director, Stephen Pask, and I were contacted. Actually, Stephen was contacted first by a local guy. And what they did is there was some kind of credit card debt or some kind of other debt. And they were allowed to place it as a lien on his house and then go after to foreclose on him to take the house. Now, I was just interviewing Valerie Lopez, and she was telling me they can't do that because of the Consumer Protection Act. You cannot take a credit card type of debt and transfer it as a lien on a house. It's actually a violation of law. But one of our local judges let it happen, and this guy couldn't understand it either. And I didn't understand it at the time. But I went to watch his case, and I think that judge, that particular judge, needs to be
removed from the bench.
Removed from the bench and given a new home in a state prison somewhere.
With an orange jumpsuit?
With an orange jumpsuit that says, I used to be a judge. Now I'm a known criminal. A former judge helping the crooked banks. And that should be put on his orange jumpsuit. So everybody in the prison knows what kind of low slime bag that judge is, because he's charged with knowing the law. And he must have been aware of the Consumer Protection Act. But this homeowner and his daughter, I actually came across, Stephen, I came across media request, and so I have the name now. And we should go talk to him, because it's not too late. Fraud was done in the court.
Yes, yes.
And I don't know what they did to him finally, but it's not too late, because fraud undoes everything back to the point of fraud. What's troubling to me, Sherry, is the judges are helping the fraudsters.
Well, they're doing it in clever ways. They're not allowing your evidence into the court record.
Yes.
Therefore, they can bury it, which I've had done to us. But I think the most egregious thing about our case in particular is with having the settlement with Countrywide, we won in part. We won a actual judgment in part against their correspondent, who was their sales manager for two offices. And they settled with us over what they had done. But during this process, the new lender that we had transferred our loan to a company called PennyMac. We had a modification. PennyMac immediately stopped the modification payment, stopped the modification, and started to move towards foreclosure, tell us we were in arrears all this amount that we weren't in arrears. And they submitted a fraudulent deed of trust. And I would like to show it here, and I will explain to you why it is fraudulent.
Did we get a shot of this yet?
Yes, we did.
There is a fraudulent deed of trust. Now keep it up there and tell us, Sherry, from the top, what's fraudulent?
Okay, they didn't substitute the trustee, who was Richard Snedden. That was not substituted in here. They're saying that they got this. They're not saying the date, but this loan was in 2008. They didn't open until 2009. Your Best Rate Financial. This is dated 1/5/12. Your Best Rate Financial was given a cease and desist order in 2009, and they were closed down completely by the state of Georgia in 2010.
So how could they be doing this in 2012?
Exactly, exactly. Todd Graves, who signed this for MERS and Your Best Rate Financial, works for PennyMac. And Karina Castillo, who notarized this, has over 107 penal code violations against her for grand theft using her notary.
Is she in jail yet?
She's convicted.
She's convicted, but is she actually in jail?
No, they gave her 5 years probation and said she has to pay back $1.5 million from the people that she stole from.
And is she starting to pay it back?
We seriously doubt she'll ever be able to do that. She's just a young lady, maybe in her mid to late 30s.
And
she's, of course, lost her job.
Yeah, of course. And I wouldn't trust her to flip burgers.
Exactly, exactly.
And so this young lady, instead of sitting in prison to think about the crimes,
right,
she passed the money on to somebody else and
right,
because she doesn't have it.
Right.
So do we know who has the money?
She put some of it in her and her husband's joint account, and I think they managed to get that money back. But there was a group called the Zepeda Gang, who opened up a mortgage modification firm and were taking money from people, promising them to modify their loans and having them write their houses over to them, saying with the pretense that they would protect them. But what I find interesting is that they were willing to convict her on that. They were willing to convict her on that, and she has signed over hundreds of documents for PennyMac.
Oh.
Both here in California and Arizona and in Nevada.
What county in California and Arizona do you know?
All over. She signed
counties
it for
all over.
Yeah, she signs them for wherever they had property.
Did she really know what she was doing?
I seriously doubt it. I think she was just an employee, just doing what she was told.
They said sign here, and she signed. And they gave her $20 an hour or something to just sign things right. She didn't know what she was doing.
And Todd Graves has numerous job titles. He works for Citibank as an associate. He works for I have a list here of some of the jobs he was claiming. In fact, here is Karina Castillo's violations. Here's her penal code violations here.
Yeah, can
and
I
this
read
is,
those?
Yeah, sure. And this is what she was convicted of.
Do we have a shot of this anywhere? No? Count 102, count 103, count 104, penal code F-E-L-L, felony.
That's a felony.
Yeah, 470D, felony, 115A, felony, 470D, felony, 115A. Wow.
115A.
Karina Esperanza Castilla.
Right.
You are a bad girl.
Right, 115A, every person who knowingly procures or offers any false or forged instrument to be filed, registered, or recorded in any public office within this state, which instrument, if genuine, might be filed, registered, or recorded under law of this state or of the United States, is guilty of a felony.
Now, what county was she prosecuted in?
Los Angeles.
And what judge let her off with probation?
I do not have that information. I have it's somewhere on there, but I didn't think of.
I particularly want to go take a hard look at that judge. I mean, he obviously looked at it and said, "You poor young fool, you didn't know what you're doing."
Well, the district attorney wrote a very compelling brief saying that she shouldn't be left off with probation because of the egregiousness of her crime.
Well, good for the DA of L.A. Which DA was that?
And again, I don't have that.
Was it assistant, senior assistant DA?
Yes, uh-huh, assistant. Mm-hmm.
Well, we can find out. His name is whatever it is.
Yes.
DA. I mean, once in a while you have a DA do the right thing.
So why is this woman? Now, I was told by the police when I found out who she was and I called the police, and of course nobody's willing to write me a declaration or anything, that they found her notary book at PennyMac.
They found her notary book at PennyMac. Isn't she supposed to keep it with her all the time as a notary?
Could be. But, well, speaking of which, we have another one that signed on there, a substitution of trustee. Now, Ackman right now is in trouble with the Department of Business Oversight for backdating. And here I have a signature for a substitution of trustee.
Do we have an image of this yet? No, not this one.
They stamped that one February the 14th, but you see it's filed in July of 2012. So I sent for her notary book, and I looked up her oath of notary recorder's office, and the address to contact her was PennyMac. So I asked for a copy of her notary book, wrote the Secretary of State. They called me back to tell me that she's lost her 2006 and 2007 notary book, and she's under investigation. She retired in 2012. And in 2012, she wrote in that she had lost her 2009 notary book also.
I think jail is appropriate for her.
I would think so, but again, she's an employee of a large corporation, and you know, these employees, they have this problem. They get paid by these corporations. Their salaries are paid by these corporations. So this is, you know, these are serious crimes that if we had done, we would not be walking on the streets right now. And these people, they just tell you, it's a civil matter.
It's not a civil matter. This is felony fraud. Backdating?
Mm-hmm.
How did the same trustee file a notice of default on 1-18-2012?
And this trustee, which is Trustee Corp, does not have a DBA in Los Angeles County where they supposedly sold this property.
So it was an illegal auction.
Right. And in Orange County, they did not have a DBA until July of 2012 or 2014. But in Los Angeles County, they do not have one at all.
Well, this one here says, I am an agent or employee. I like that, officer, agent, or just an employee of MTC Financial, Inc., doing business as Trustee Corp, whose address is Gillett Avenue, Irvine. That's 17,100 Gillett Avenue, Irvine, California. That's Orange County, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Do they have a DBA in Orange County that you
They know? Did not have one until I think it was 2012 or 2014, but they've been in business a long time.
Wow. So you've been busy documenting their fraud, Sherry.
Yes, I have.
You've been a busy, busy lady. You know, we
That's
saw...
because we are not deadbeats, and I am so tired of having people say, oh, these homeowners got into this.
I think it's time we should show people who these auctioneers are and what they do. Let's roll that DVD. One where the lady flips us the finger. I had just showed up to document this auction. It was like 1 o'clock, and the auction was set for 1:30. Of Cindy Brown's house, mm-hmm. November 2nd.
Yes.
And so I'm there a half hour early. I don't know who's who. I'm just there to wait till someone steps up and say, I'm auctioning. And get him out. And this chubby little girl looks at me and covers her face and then flips me the finger. I'm not joking. I'm not kidding about this. Let's roll that and see if we can find her chubby little face.
And interesting.
Okay, there she is. Now she's, we don't even know her name is. She's one of those auctioneers. I'm just scanning the area. I didn't know she was. And back there, you see Cindy Brown, way back there in the dark outfit, waiting for auction to come up. Now watch what this gal does. This is the front. Is this familiar to you, Sherry?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
This is the city center drive of, what is she doing? Is she telling me I'm number one in her
Excuse
book?
Me?
What's the finger
yes,
for?
With her middle finger.
For you film? I don't want to be filmed.
Who are you?
I understand, but I don't want to be filmed.
Well, okay, duly noted, but there's no law against filming in a public place.
And there's no law against flipping you off.
Now, this is the quality of auctioneers and people that work for these foreclosure people. I just wanted you to see this. I couldn't believe any... Yeah, let it roll ahead till you get to where we got the gal up against the wall, not giving us her name, not giving us her auctioneer's license or anything.
She doesn't have an auctioneer's license. She doesn't have a bond. They're doing these illegally. The same.
You were there too, weren't you?
Yes. The same people show up. The same people show up to buy these properties. No money changes hands.
Which is a mandate. That's why it's called an auction.
You don't even see a check being passed over to them.
I was there with Sherry this time. This was, what, November 2nd?
Yes.
Uh-huh. This is just a few days ago, this week. And I was there, 200 miles south of here at Orange County, documented. Sherry was documented, and there was another guy with his camera rolling. And it was amazing how rude these auctioneers were. And we're just asking for what... they're supposed to have, right?
Right.
They're supposed to not just tell us, they're supposed to show us their auctioneer's license.
Mm-hmm.
They're supposed to give us their name and the company they work for. Not just show up, I'm auctioning off this. Well, I might stand up here and say, well, I'm auctioning off Judge Herman's house and I'm auctioning off Judge Regali's house. Who wants to bid? You know, I'm not going to tell you my name. I'm not going to authenticate that I have a license. I'm just going to auction it off. Who's bidding? What was weird is that gal we just saw then left. Do we have that shot of her when she left?
What infuriates me about that is that you know Cindy Brown.
Very well.
Cindy
now.
Brown is an Olympic athlete. Yep. She has been well trained. She's been disciplined all her life. She worked hard for representing our country. And they're stealing her house from her. I've seen her paperwork. I've gone through it. They describe her as a white woman in her paperwork.
And yeah, you know you're aligned when you read the form, and I did. Cindy brought the form. She was sitting right here where you were, I don't know how many months ago, and I read the form. It says, I am face-to-face with the applicant. She is a white woman. And I'm looking at Cindy. He said, wow, you've got a great tan, Cindy. You're really tan. You know, it was such blatant, obvious fraud. She didn't get that money. She didn't even know the loan had been taken out. Yeah, let's go to that. And Sherry was there. This is at the public side of the Orange County Courthouse, which, by the way, there she is. Now, this gal, we think her name is Daniela. She really did not like us taping her. And she starts to read the list.
Do you have a bond?
Do you have a bond?
A bond to sell under 18-12-600. Ma'am, you're interfering with business.
Where's your bond?
Please stop. Do you have a bond to sell that property, 17841 East Lincoln Street, Villa Park?
Where's your bond?
Accept this as your subpoena.
I'm not going to.
That's her bankruptcy filing.
Should do a citizen's arrest.
If she sells that property, we have the Orange County Sheriff's in back here. We have new information which shows that there's notary fraud. We are opening up an official complaint on anyone here at the auction that is going to be bidding on that property, including but not limited to the auction bidder. The notary fraud was just discovered on Friday. We actually found that the notary journal was empty, and we'd like the sheriff to take a criminal report against this document, which also involves New Century, the seal that is not visible here. Was accepted in the county recorder's office. We got certified copies of this document, and it found that this was not a legally notarized document in the county recorder's journal. In the notary journal, it is now under 6203 of the California Government Code. A felony.
Did she recognize who she is? Did she announce her name?
No, she's not going to announce herself.
She has to by law.
She doesn't have a bond and she doesn't have an auctioneer's license. Who's going to make the citizen's arrest here? This person needs to be arrested.
She has not given her name. She's not shown a bond. That's illegal.
She needs to be arrested and the sheriff's deputies can take it from there.
A notary may not notarize a mortgage and then not have it in the journal.
against that property and try to foreclose on it. This is a live, it is being Ustreamed. Everyone's watching. You've been warned. If the sheriff's department wants to do their...
Now she's calling for help. I don't know if you caught that, but she got on her cell phone,
uh-huh.
and she mumbled something about being arrested,
uh-huh.
and, you know, and she still was told to go ahead. And then later this man comes, who's also an auctioneer,
mm-hmm.
the chubby gal, we'll see her in a little bit, I followed her, she left. And apparently, Sherry, what happened?
She made a deal before she left.
She made a deal before she left, she would call in a bid. And then Danielle announced, oh, we have a bid by phone, or something like that. And so it sold. Cindy Brown's household, in spite of all this fraud. And Sherry, were there not two Orange County sheriff's deputies standing there watching this crime be committed?
They were watching the crime being committed, and they said all they could do was keep the peace. But it's interesting that the only ones they were attempting to keep the peace with was the people they're observing and saying this is a crime. They didn't bother to try and keep the peace with those that were committing the crime.
Do you catch that, people? So you have the Orange County, and one of them was named Stump, the female sheriff with the blonde ponytail. Her name was Stump. And the other one was Shevers or something like that, C-H-A-V-E-R-S, I believe. I think it was T.J. Shevers. And at least twice I asked them to assist in arresting her. And all they would say is, we're just here to keep the peace. Well, the peace is being broken because the crime's being committed. Wasn't it, Sherry?
Yes, it was. Yes, it was.
I mean, you've been at this longer than I have. Was that not a crime done right in front of the Orange County Sheriff's deputies?
Yes, it was. They are circumventing the law. They didn't have the proper procedures. They didn't have a notary bond. I mean, yeah, a notary bond or a bond for being...
Or an auctioneer's bond.
An auctioneer's bond, that's what I meant. And they didn't have... They weren't open enough to give their name and who they were and that they had a license for doing what they're doing. There was no money that exchanged hands, no check that we could see. They weren't willing to publicly give the name of the person that supposedly bought the property. And this is going on all over. And we see these same people, just two or three handful of people, showing up at these various auctions and buying the property. In our particular case of the auction, we got a release from stay on the 16th of April. And on the 17th of April, they claimed that they carried an auction out, even though it was listed on their website a month later. Now, they're supposed to post it so that people can actually come to this auction, but they didn't have time to post it for that date. And, they later claimed, well, you know, since you had it in stay, we could have done it any time. But that's not true. We're supposed to be given 5 days for rescission, which we were not given. And this is going on all over. They're blatantly stealing properties. And the woman from the Department of Business Oversight at one of the meetings we attended said it's easier to steal a house than it is to steal a car.
Apparently so. They have perfected white-collar crime down to a science where the sheriff's deputies will protect the criminals. Even, and Cindy did, she said, look, here's a certified copy of the notary's page where my signature's not even there. They didn't even fake her signature. There was no Cindy Brown signature for that date that they put on the phony documents. And I suspect that the real notary didn't even know their notary had been faked and a fake copy of their seal had been made and stamped on those fake documents.
Well, actually, since that time, she found out that the notary who notarized that document was a attorney.
What do I think about attorneys? When I think about attorneys and bar association, I get these visions of these outhouses overflowing with manure, just turning into a volcano as the manure piles up, and the little outhouse keeps climbing higher and higher, and everybody's got to look up to the attorney. He knows how to do this. Yeah, he sure does. He'll bury you in a pile of feces and take your money for the service. Well, where, you know, there was one good attorney down in, I mean, I can't just say they're all bad, but there was, yeah, let's see that. There was a good attorney in San Diego that stopped B of A from foreclosing on hundreds of thousands of mortgages. They later put him in jail for some other bogus reason.
I'm not surprised.
You know, there are Tom Mesereaux around, but he deals with murder and serious crimes. Now here you see, that's a car. She was driving a white Ford last time, and that's her car she's driving. It's a dark green black car, and she gets in her car and she drives away. Now this is the chubby young lady that was flipping me the finger when I hadn't done anything and the auction hadn't even started. And she gets in her car with the tinted windows, and she immediately pulls away, goes down an alley. This is like a half a block from the, right? About a half a block from
yes.
the from the front of the Orange County Courthouse, where our representatives, elected offices, are supposed to help us.
The Department of Justice on September 9th of this year wrote a letter, a memo, to all of the attorney generals in the United States saying that it was time that they started going after these bankers. They said that this repeat of crimes only causes them to continue, and that they should start prosecuting and bringing them to justice. Now, I thought that was interesting that this letter went out, so I went ahead and sent him a copy of our documents, because one of the things they brought up was that these same players are doing it again. And nothing, again, is more egregious than Countrywide reopening as PennyMac, and they're doing it again. In California, the LexisNexis recently sent out on their 16th annual mortgage fraud report, again, said California is moving up in place for insider collusion. And they're saying that it's mostly industry professionals that are responsible for this fraud that's going on. So if it's mostly industry professionals, if the FBI is saying 80% of mortgage fraud was from insider investors, why are all the homeowners losing their homes and being called deadbeats while these guys are getting new jobs and bonuses?
I have a solution. They send the militia after an indictment by a We the People grand jury. And you know, you crooked judges ought to be fearful. You should be fearful, you crooked judges. Because once the people get the We the People under the SCOTUS ruling of U.S. versus William 504 U.S. 36, where Antoine Scalia, one of the Supreme Court justices, says it doesn't belong to the justice system. It doesn't belong to the executive or the legislative. The We the People grand jury belongs to us, the people, and we can form them of our own volition, and we should. So you crooked judges and you crooked DAs that are not prosecuting these guys, you should be fearful, because once we get this started, I doubt that they will stop with just arresting these low-level auctioneers. They're going to go for the DAs. The judges said, oh, that's good enough for me. The bank says they own it, they own it. Click, here's your UD, kick her out of her own house. I think they're going to go after the judges, the sheriff deputies like Stumpf and Chavez that sat there and watched a felony committed right in front of them. Well, I asked, and I think Renee Powers asked as well, if we do the citizen's arrest, will you take her into custody and finish it? And all they say is, we're here to keep the peace. We're here to keep the peace. Which means if you touch her, we're going to arrest you because
right.
you're breaking the peace.
Right.
They're going to protect the felons. This is white-collar crime perfected. Perfected, because they do it over and over. They bribe the judges. Someone, I don't know if it's true. Renee said to these two useless Orange County sheriff's deputies, well, you're getting a bonus. You're getting some kind of a
kickback.
And she said, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? We're just here to keep the peace. Now, I don't agree with Renee. We don't know that those two particular deputies, but I would not be surprised if some senior sheriff deputy who put them there and told them, just keep the peace. if they weren't getting some kind of kickback. Because you can't do crime openly, blatantly, in front of the sheriffs with people objecting. And Cindy, as Sherry said, is a trained Olympian. She's calm in the face of great adversity. She's played many, many basketball games. She, in 1988, she won gold medal. Her team won gold medals in the Olympics. This is not some average black woman who dropped out of high school and had five babies and got on welfare. No, 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 no. That's not the Cindy Brown. Cindy Brown, we know, is a gold Olympian, used to live in, I think, Oregon, moved down here, became a professional athlete, won the gold medal, became a professional athlete, and like Sherry said, she traveled the world playing basketball games, representing the American team. That's like a goodwill ambassador.
And what infuriated me about that event is that chubby little property buyer had the audacity to call her a deadbeat who didn't pay her mortgage, not knowing anything about her. And what has that girl done with her life except to work for criminals buying property illegally?
I think eventually we will find out who little Miss Chubby Single Finger is. And she'll get a re-education. I think you're right. I think she doesn't really know that she's working for criminals. All she knows is she's making more money faster than any other hamburger flipping job she ever had. But I mean, that just shows you. Now, there's Cindy Brown. And go ahead, roll that, Stephen.
Department to create a transaction of theft. That's what we want to focus on. Keep your focus on them.
Yep. Officer T.J. Schaffer's here.
It is not a
C-H-A-V-E-R-S. Refuses to make arrests.
The notary fraud has been recognized.
He just doesn't want the people entering or the entrance tape.
No.
So they moved over from the location they were right next to. They were right there. And now they moved over to the
nationwide entrance. Posting has published my information online. They've been a dissolved corporation through the Certificate of Dissolution, December 20th, 2013. The Secretary of State document number Diaz and Dog 121-6045, and their second certificate of status dissolved C-188-7431, which is on record. It is shown and proved that this corporation does not exist. They are using corporations that are no longer existent. In fact, this auction here, they are Index West, and it specifically states here, notice to potential bidders, if you are considering bidding on this property lien, you should understand that there are risks involved in bidding at a trustee auction. You will be bidding on a lien, not on the property itself. Placing the highest bid at a trustee auction does not automatically entitle you to free and clear ownership of the property. You should always be aware that the lien of the lien auction.
That was Cindy being calm while they are illegally
stealing her home.
And it's a fraudulent auction because you can't have auctioneers working for the same company bidding on the house. As Sherry said, that's called insider. And you can't do it. It's illegal. So we have multiple people caught on tape committing felonies, don't we, Sherry?
Yes, we do. Yes,
and we have
do.
The Orange County Sheriff standing there just looking buff and tough and not arresting the criminals. And you got a new female sheriff in Orange County. What's her name? Do you know?
I'm not from Orange County.
Oh,
I'm
sorry.
I'm from Los Angeles County.
That's right. You're from Los Angeles County.
I get lazy.
But you were down there. You saw this whole thing
go
down.
Yes, yes.
So I didn't make any of this up, did it?
No, you didn't. I was there. I saw the whole thing.
This was not a reenactment, was it?
No, it wasn't.
This was the real thing. And I told Cindy afterwards, you know, I wouldn't worry too much about it because it was all fraud. It's void ab initio from the beginning. And if the FBI keeps dragging their feet, maybe this will cause a black militia to take action. Now, I know what happens when the black people get really, really upset. We had a thing called the Rodney King riots.
Ooh.
And if you want to see a black militia go into full force with the law on their side as an armed militia supporting an indictment by a we the people, mostly black people, grand jury, just keep letting the white collar criminals, and these were white people besides committing the white collar criminals, and then have a black militia come in to protect Cindy, and you will have the equivalent of another riot like the Rodney King's riot. And how many millions of dollars of buildings were burned up when that riot was over?
Oh, it's...
It was in the hundreds of millions.
Was it priceless?
Yeah, but you know, it was a cleansing of the soul because the cops stood down and hid like cowards in L.A. and just waited for the military to come in. That's how bad it was. If you don't remember the Rodney King riots, it started with Rodney King being videotaped as the cops, white cops, kept beating this black man. Yeah, he ran away. He shouldn't have run away in his car, speeding and blah, blah. But you don't get to beat the man senseless, tasering him and beating him with a club because he finally pulled over. Whether he was high on drugs or not, I don't care. It's irrelevant. You don't get to beat a man like they beat him, like he was a snake or something in the ground. But I could perceive, you know, if ordinary people of good
character
and common sense who happen to be white will not stand up to the plate and say, this stops now, Sheriff of Orange County, you're a woman, you ought to do better than the last crooked sheriff, Mike Corona, who, let me remind you, I told our sheriff of Santa Barbara County, this guy's in trouble. He's going to jail. I told him right here on the set of On Second Thought years ago, years before the FBI indicted him. And Mike Corona did just get out of jail, out of Club Fed, for a felony. And it started with me outing the guy on my website, which then mysteriously disappeared. But it didn't stop there. And Mike Corona went to prison. I think he shouldn't even be allowed to collect his pension. But that's a different issue. So I'm talking to you, the new sheriff of Orange County, who succeeded the corrupt Mike Corona, which, Sherry, I think is funny because I looked up his campaign material. Mike Corona was elected to clean up the sheriff's department. And he was the worst, crookedest. I tried to get a copy. I could only see it on the internet. I wanted a physical copy of the Orange County Grand Jury where they were talking about Mike Corona having sex with his wives of his senior deputies and still won re-election. Well, they had a clean, apparently clean, deputy sheriff running against him, and Mike Corona still won re-election. And when that happened, then the FBI said, okay, we got to do something. Too many people, it's reached all the way up to Santa Barbara. This guy, this nutcase Wagner in Santa Barbara knows we got a crooked sheriff. And it's spreading. Too many people know we got to take him down. So they took him down. They, I think, originally charged Mike Corona, the Orange County Sheriff, with 107 felonies. But they only went to trial, I think, on, what, 6-7 felonies? Convicted him on 2 and 3, and 1 or 2 were overturned on appeal. And the one that stuck had to do with when they had a deputy approach him with a wiretap. And he tried to persuade the deputy to shut his mouth, not talk about something. That's what they stuck him on. What about the other 100 felonies? Hello? Hello, FBI? Hello? Couldn't you go back because fraud was in a lot of those and take Mike Corona and put him back in Club Fed for the other 100 felonies? And sheriff, the current sheriff, whose name is... You should think about where Mike Corona spent 6 years. You've got white-collar crime going on right in front of your nose with your deputies, and you're sitting there doing nothing about it. I think Cindy's going to try to contact you, make an appointment. I think you should listen to Cindy Brown. Don't you, Sherry?
Yes, I do. I think that our government ought to start listening to all of the middle-class citizens who are crying foul for this fraud that's been going on. And I want to know why the laws are so strict to the homeowners that they're beyond what the laws actually say. And yet when we come in with our paperwork and say, here's a fraud, they say, oh, well, that doesn't count because you didn't pay your mortgage. Well, we can't pay our mortgage when we don't have anyone to pay it to. And since they fraudulently removed our loans from the original lender, there isn't a lender left that is accepting the money. They're allowed to use our obligation of debt as extortion rather than working with us and putting our homes back in line. They were supposed to modify, and had they modified people's homes as they had agreed to do, we would probably be improved in our whole economy right now. But instead, they use the modifications as extortion to charge them excessive fees, to tack extra interest onto the back of the loan and then come back later. And right now, I've read that some of those modifications where they've tacked all that interest onto the back are coming due, and there's going to be new foreclosures ahead.
A pile of new foreclosures. But in Cindy Brown's case, her identity was stolen. Her cash, stocks, and bonds in her accounts were all stolen. She didn't get it. And the mortgage they took out on her house, she didn't get that mortgage money. So she's not a deadbeat. They paid off the original mortgage that she had signed, and then they took out a huge, gargantuan mortgage and put the money in their pocket. Cindy
exactly.
didn't get it.
Cindy and she tried to rescind that the minute it happened. She has letters of rescission that she sent in the minute she found out about it. And here it is 8 years later, and they never took care of it. They kept it going all this time, and they've been stealing from her just continually.
Continually, and still are to this day. But she's still in her house, and I'm talking to you, Sheriff of Orange County. If you want to stop a bloodbath, you need to sit down with Cindy Brown and get the facts straight, and then go talk to Tony Rakakis, that crooked district attorney you have, the one that let Cincinnati and Ramos get away with the murder of Kelly Thomas, Ron Thomas, an ex-police officer's son. He let them get away with it, did the worst prosecution I've ever seen the DA do. You need to go talk to Tony and make sure he starts prosecuting these people we're showing you on film. And listen to Cindy Brown. She's a good person. She's an Olympic gold medal winner, and she has been exceedingly patient with your tomfoolery and your buffoonery and your Keystone cops standing there saying, we're here to keep the peace. No, they weren't. They were there to make sure white-collar criminals got away with their white-collar crime. And it's your job as the new sheriff of Orange County to do something about it. Yes, I'm talking to you, the new sheriff, who replaced a crooked sheriff who went to prison. And I don't think you want to be the next sheriff of Orange County that goes to prison. But if you remember the Rodney King riots, just phantom in your mind Cindy Brown calling for a black militia to defend her house. And 2,000 armed black people come up from South Central Los Angeles and say, ain't no way you're taking Cindy's house. And they surround that lily white neighborhood that she lives in. Just percolate that. Park Villa, surrounded with 2,000 armed militia there to defend one Olympian's house. Is that what you want in Orange County? And there's something crooked about that city manager, Park Villa. I can't put my finger on it, but I interviewed him, and he was fishy. You need to do your job, Sheriff. Whether you're a woman sheriff or a male sheriff, you need to do your job. What else you got, Sherry? I'm talking too much. You came a long way.
That's the sheriff of Orange County.
Let me see. Yeah.
Well, this I have my story is in this book called Dollar Democracy, and this is written by Peter Matthews, and he's a full-time political science professor at Cypress College. And this book has been going around as he's been talking about what's going on in our country, how money is running our country now instead of the people. So money is being influenced in all areas of our country. We've got the super PACs that are trying to elect the latest president. And we have corporations being called people now, although in the case of these
corporations.
Yeah,
called persons.
Persons, yeah.
They're legal persons, but they're not people.
But they can't get arrested and put in jail.
I think we should have lost the whole corporate officers and put them in jail.
I agree.
Like Pelican Bay. Prison, state prison, underground, never see the sun for a couple of years. I think that would give them a change of attitude. You had a book here called Dollar Democracy.
Right, right. And this is by Peter Matthews. And this is what he talks about, why the money.
Have you seen this book? Do we have a shot of this?
Yes, we do.
There it is. Dollar Democracy by Peter Matthews. How much would you recommend this book?
I would definitely recommend this book, especially since my story's in there about what we've been through. And that's just the first half with Countrywide. That doesn't encompass what I'm going through now with Penny Mac. But this story...
But you're still in your house, right?
No, I'm not.
Oh, they got you out. Countrywide or Penny Mac?
Penny Mac got us out of our house.
The same criminals.
The same criminals got us out of our house. And they did it quite cleverly because we had a... We had a judge in Long Beach who was willing to hear our case and willing to look at our documents. He said there was legislation that allowed him to do so. So while we had left the room to go get our lawyers, the lawyer for Penny Mac went and got the date extended, came out, told us that they had our trial date extended for 2 weeks when that judge was on vacation. And they had sent their witnesses home, and then she took off practically running. And I had no experience. I'm left there saying, huh? You know, I thought we were going to have our case heard by this judge. 2 weeks later, we're heard by a judge who does a summary judgment without allowing us any witnesses or any evidence to be brought into trial. Then later, I go for appeal, and the attorney that I had on the appeal ran out on us 2.5 weeks. Before the appeal was due. So I had to write the appeal by myself, and I was
Did you pay that attorney money?
Yes, I did.
Did you get your money back?
No, I did not.
Should he go to jail for thievery?
Yes, she should. Uh-huh.
Her name wasn't Lenora by any chance,
yes,
was it?
Yes, it was.
It wasn't Lenora Alberts.
Yes, it was.
Do you think she's a crook?
Yes, I do.
Well, you know, George Olivos does, and so does Cindy Brown, and so do a lot of people think, and I'm wondering... Why does the Bar Association allow Lenora? I mean, you can't be lying, Cindy lying, George lying, all these people lying. Even her assistant, Tim, quit working for her and left the area, went to Florida or Hawaii, I think.
My case is documented. My case is documented.
It's partially documented in this book, isn't it?
No, not that part. Because that's only the first half. That's not the Penny Mac half. This is the Countrywide half. But my case is documented in the courts. It shows that she was left as attorney of record. She would not sign the substitution of attorney until the day where the brief was due. And then she tells the state bar that because I wrote her a letter telling her not to do anything on my case, well, I wrote a letter telling her that since she fired herself from my case, she needed to let the court know because the court wouldn't even talk to me until she signed the substitution of attorney.
So would you say the smartest thing a person could do is not hire an attorney?
And definitely not elect her to office.
And don't elect any to office. Yeah, I have a bumper sticker in my car. It says, never vote for lawyers. Don't vote. Save America. Don't vote for lawyers.
Well, I understand that she's running for office.
Lenora Alberts is
yes.
running for office?
Yes.
You're joking.
No, I'm not.
This has got to be a joke. The Koshaks lost her house. Cindy thought she was going to do something for her, and Cindy just had her house auctioned off. What? I'm almost afraid to ask what Lenora's running for.
Assembly member, I think.
Sure, you're running for cover. You know, I thought when I first met her, she was maybe one of those rare breeds like Tom Mesro, Michael Minns. I mean, I can count on my hand the number of attorneys that are actually decent human beings and will actually charge you money, yes, but they will actually do the work mm-hmm. for the money. Mm-hmm. And you will get results. Michael Jackson got results with Tom Mesro and Susan Yu. That elderly couple got 67 felonies from the IRS going after them, blown away in front of a jury by Michael Minns.
If the sheriff's department wants to do their constitutional jobs.
Sheriff,
they can make
a note and arrest you.
They can make reference to this document. It is a certified. It is certified. It has been reported to the assessor's department and to the administrator, director, over at the county recorder's office. Everybody knows about this property.
Ms. Brown, did
the
you?
Notaries are a fraud. It's not in the journal.
Did you show the sheriffs? Did you tell them it's a certified document?
They want to say it's a civil matter. It's now criminal.
It's a criminal matter, and the sheriffs are not.
We also confirmed the notaries from South Carolina.
This is when you need a militia and you need a... It's not rocket science, people. It's called not selling out your client. You simply do the briefs, file things. If they put in a bunch of lies, you have to answer the lies and specifically and generally deny each lie. It's not rocket science. But you can learn it. And Sherry just said you had to do it yourself.
I had to do it myself, uh-huh.
At the last minute, because your attorney dropped the ball.
Yeah, I had a consultant help me do the brief, but he didn't do it until the day before it was due, so I didn't have a chance to go over it and make sure that everything was in there that was supposed to be in there. Missed a couple of things. So on their reply brief, I filled them in for the response.
The important thing is getting it in on time,
well,
by the date. You can make an amended reply, can't you?
Well,
this was the appeal.
Right. The judges ruled, since I didn't put everything in my opening brief, that they weren't going to count it. So they said things like, since your previous attorney didn't write a declaration, well, my previous attorney did write a declaration that I put in my reply. But since I didn't put it in my opening brief, they said it didn't count. So I requested a rehearing, and they wouldn't give me a rehearing. They knew my attorney had deserted me. They knew that I didn't have experience and I had to go in and write it, but they didn't give me a rehearing. And this is why people are not trusting the justice nowadays.
Who could? I mean, that's an oxymoron.
Yeah.
Trust the courts?
Yeah.
Are you kidding? Why not just go to Satan and say, Satan, give me your best verdict? You know, because it's going to be the same if you go in front of a court of law with these bar-carded people. And let me say it again in case you missed it. There is not an attorney in California, Texas, or any of the 50 states that has a license to practice law issued by a state employee. That's right. All their bar-carded licenses are just certificates from their private club.
The state bar?
Yeah, the state bar. It's just a private club. It's a corporation. Yeah, it's under regulation, but it's a private club, people. It's not the state issuing them a license. And in fact, they can't because it's already been ruled by the Supreme Court. The right to practice law is a common law right and it cannot be licensed because it belongs to all of us, we the people. It belongs to all of us. But the high schools don't teach you any of this. The colleges don't teach you any of this. It's only when you find yourself in Sherry's position being flim-flam by a crooked attorney in the justice system, you're forced to learn it, aren't you?
I've learned more about the law than I never thought possible for a former fashion designer.
For a former fashion designer. And Cindy just wants to go back to promoting girls in healthy basketball activities. She doesn't want to spend her life fighting this fraudulent stealing of her house, but they force her to. They absolutely force her to. And that's where we all need, when you see a judge come up for election, you need to ask that judge to his face, are you going to allow the truth and the facts to get on the record? And if he doesn't give you the right answer, even if he does, you probably want to vote him off if he's incumbent, because they get corrupt. They're in there for 6 years, they're already corrupt. And I don't think any member of the bar should be elected to any judgeship, even though they've made it a law, Sherry. They've made it a law. You must be a member of the bar to be elected judge, which to me violates the practice of law because a judge sitting as a referee is, in effect, practicing law as a neutral referee.
Mm-hmm.
So that violates our common law right to have common law judges. When those, you know, if you people in the city in the black robes don't start doing things right, and I'm thinking of Kathleen Bauer. Have you ever heard of that name,
yeah,
Sherry?
Yeah, that I've many times.
You're going to find someday, you're going to find that justice is going to come to you suddenly and with very little mercy. Because you crooked judges doing your crooked thing day in and day out think you're all protected. It ain't so. What else we got? Because we're almost out of time.
We got the notary fraud. We have no bond. We have no name being announced. She won't. All right, what is your name? This is a crime right here.
He's a crime.
What company you work for, what your bond number is, what your name is.
Sir, if you like,
announcing the property. You need to give your name. You need to give your name and what company you work for. And a bond.
Where's the bond?
I didn't get to all these documents. I like this one. Here are some of the laws that have been broken. We've got the 38th Congress, 13 Stat 99, where it says that any order or bill of exchange, make any exception, assign any note, bond, draft, bill or exchange, mortgage, judgment, or decree, or shall make any false entry in any book, report, statement of them association with intent in either case to injure or defraud the association or any other company, body, political or corporate, or any individual person, shall be punished by imprisonment of not less than 5, nor more than 10. U.S. Code 1324. It is unlawful for any person or entity knowingly to forge, counterfeit, alter, or falsely make any document for the purpose of satisfying a requirement of this chapter or obtain a benefit under this chapter. Civil Code 1335:17, no one can take advantage of his own wrong. And my favorite quote here is, the most elementary concept of justice and public policy require that the wrongdoer shall bear the risk of uncertainty which his own wrong has created. Let me say that again. The wrongdoer, these banks and all of these individual corporations and servicers that are saying, oh, you know, the homeowner's going to get a free house. They are the ones that have to bear the responsibility of their own wrong. They have committed the wrong. They should have to bear the responsibility of the wrong, not the people that have entered into these agreements in good faith. Penal Code 134, every person guilty of preparing a false annotated book, paper, record, instrument in writing, or other matter with intent to produce it or to allow it to be produced for any fraudulent or deceitful purpose as genuine or true upon any trial, proceeding, or inquiry whatsoever authorized by law is guilty of a felony. So why are people losing their homes when they bring fraudulent documents into the courts?
I think, Sherry, my guess is, after looking at a couple of Form 700's financial disclosure, mm-hmm. of several judges who hadn't already hidden it all in a trust, is that they own stock in the major banks. And no matter what happens, they don't want the banks to fail because their retirement pensions are vested in these banks. And that's a clear conflict of interest, which they never tell us about. Now, what else you got there? You got some more documents there.
Your Best Rate Financial that we got our loan from. They are telling us now that these loans are securities, right? Okay, well, these are securities, and they're filed on the security market. Well, I have a letter here from the Security and Exchange Commission. Here it is. This says, your Best Rate Financial is not licensed or legally allowed to file securities, and there are no record of them having filed any securities on the market.
Oh, my goodness.
There's no record of them having filed any securities on the market. So if they're trying to tell me that my loan is a security instrument and that they disclose that to me, why is it that they never filed the security? In fact, having followed the security and followed the loan from inception till PennyMac had it, 3 years later when PennyMac had it, they filed it as a security. So without a contract with us, without our authorization, yeah, and without our signature. Nor would we have ever done business with PennyMac knowing who they were, since we were in a lawsuit with countrywide at the time.
Fraud, 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 and more fraud. White collar crime perfected. Did you want to get into any of those documents?
Well, most of these documents just outline the case, but someone had asked me about the title of my document, Foam on the Runway. And I took the title Foam on the Runway from the book by Neil Barofsky, who was the former Special Inspector General of the TARP funds, hired by Congress to oversee what was going on with the TARP funds. And Neil Barofsky later stepped down from his position. He felt like the... when he wrote his book Bailout, he's the first one that said that Congress bailed out Wall Street and sold out Main Street. And
when did he do that?
He wrote this book, I think, in 2012, and it's called Bailout. And in it, he said he got in a discussion with Tim Geithner, an argument actually, where he said, I don't see how the homeowners are being helped. And Tim Geithner told him, you don't understand. These modifications are just foam on the runway, so the banks don't have to go under by foreclosing all at once.
Wow.
And that's a book that's available in any bookstore, public library, and tells
name,
you...
The name of it is?
Bailout by Neil Barofsky. If our own government officials can't be believed...
Wow. And this one, Fraudulent Assignment of Deed of Trust. You brought this to tell us something about it.
Yeah, this one I had shared earlier. This shows all the fraud on the assignment of deed of trust that they used to steal our home from us. Yeah. This one, Karina Castile, was convicted of grand theft for fraudulently using her.
And she got probation.
And she got probation.
Five years probation. How many people lost their house for her to simply get a slap on the hand and probation?
I think it was 167.
167 people lose their house and all she gets... You're right. It's easier to steal a house than to steal a car. They'll put you in prison for stealing a car.
And this man who signed off as associate secretary for MERS, by the way, MERS wasn't authorized to do business in California until July 21st of 2010.
We had a close-up of this already, didn't we?
Yeah. And so he has signed off as several different positions on hundreds of documents.
She's got the fraud in red letters to help you understand it. Oh, Sherry, thank you for doing all this work and putting this together. I hope it helps somebody out there.
I do, too.
Then you got who in the world's...
Who in the world is Rita Garcia? So when
who is Rita Garcia?
Rita Garcia is the woman who wrote...
Do we have a close-up shot of that?
No, we don't have a... close up, but she wrote a supplemental declaration saying that she knew about the transfer of our property. And in this declaration, she never names the secured creditor. She calls him secured creditor, but they're never given a name.
Yeah,
because there was no secured creditor. Yeah.
Do you see, people, why we need our own We the People grand juries? With our own armed militia, armed to the teeth.
But there's no law against filming in a public place.
And there's no law against flipping you off.
My goodness.
If the sheriffs won't do the job, then the fourth branch of government, we the people, will have to do the job. Sherry, I want to thank you for being with us today.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
Oh, it was a pleasure, because you were there for Cindy as I was there for Cindy. And actually, we could see you in the background in that video. You were getting that camera angle from a different angle. I hope we get these people prosecuted without a lot of violence and bloodshed. You know what Thomas Jefferson said? Every generation, they will have to shed the blood of patriots and the villains in order to maintain liberty. Well, I'm William Wagner with Sherry Hernandez, who came up from Los Angeles County, a long, long drive, to be with us this Friday night. The 6th of November. Kind of makes me think about Guy Fawkes Day, you know. He got executed before they could blow up a palace in England 400 years ago. I think it was in 1605. They caught him. And I wonder how history might have changed as he had succeeded in his group. They were rebelling against, it was King James I, and sometimes known as the 6th of England. I don't like violence. I've been to a civil war in Vietnam.
But it looks to me, Sherry, if the sheriffs won't do the jobs and the DAs like Tony Rakakis of Orange County is crooked, like Tom Snedden of Santa Barbara County was crooked, then we, the people, will have to do it. And believe me, you don't want me firing a gun because I'm old and my vision ain't that good. You know, and I may aim for one bad guy and hit two other bad guys I didn't mean to hit. So it's going to have to be young guys in their 30s that got good vision and a steady hand, because my hand isn't that steady anymore.
But there's no law against filming in a public place.
And there's no law against flipping you off.
Oh, my goodness.
And with that, I bid you adieu, people, and we've got some music to go out with. And thank you so much. And look for the California 18 on my YouTube channel. Watch part 3 of California 18 with Candace Jones. She's telling you, you can't modify fraud. All these loans are fraud. We ought to just have Congress declare all loans null and void, and everybody keep their house free and clear. Here's some music. Relax, Congress.